Good afternoon. I'm Nadine Hani. I present the business news on Al Arabiya News Channel. Thank you for joining us and welcome to the Outlook on the Global Agenda 2015 panel discussion. As the theme of this session indicates, we will try over the next hour to discuss some of the most important global issues of our time. In its Outlook on the Global Agenda, the World Economic Forum brought together experts who are renowned not only for their thought leadership, but also for their commitment to find solutions that will improve the state of the world. Their aim was to identify the top trends that will shape the world in 2015 and the key challenges that face the world's regions. The findings of the 2015 Global Outlook publication were different from previous years. At a time when global concerns about the financial crisis seem to have subsided, the participants identified worsening income inequality as the top trend shaping the world in 2015. The divide between rich and poor became part of a widespread public debate following the publication this year of Thomas Piketty's Capital in the 21st Century, where he argued that capitalism may permit the wealthy to pull ahead of the rest of society at ever faster rates. Bloomberg recently published a feature article debating whether quantitative easing exacerbated the divide between rich and poor at a time when monetary policy spurred growth but failed to create the needed jobs. Hence, the heightened risk of jobless recovery, another trend on the outlook for this year. As a result, we are seeing a backlash against globalization and a retreat to nationalism, which takes us to the political landscape, where the rise of extremism, as seen in events across the Middle East this year, constitutes one of the major regional challenges for our part of the world. Exacerbating this challenge is a lack of global leadership. Instead of innovating and collaborating to tackle societal and economic challenges, nations and leaders are retreating into isolationism. Of course, 75 minutes are not enough to cover those topics, but we will try as much as possible. I have with me a panel of experts. Please join me in welcoming them. I will introduce them in the order in which they are seated. Next to me is Mr. Kevin Rudd, Senior Fellow at the Belfer Center on International Relations at the Harvard Kennedy School and twice Prime Minister of Australia previously. Ms. Amina Mohammed is Assistant Secretary General and Special Advisor on Post-2015 Development Planning at the UN. Dr. Rola Dashti is Chairman at FARO International, and she was Minister of State Planning and Development Affairs in Kuwait and the first female Member of Parliament in Kuwait. Mr. Majid Jafar is the CEO of Crescent Petroleum here in the UAE. And Dr. Adam Posen is president of the Peterson Institute for International Economics from the USA. So thank you very much for joining us today. Mr. Rudd, I would like to start with you. As we said, the outlook outlined very important trends that will shape the agenda of policymakers in 2015. But when you are a contributor to the outlook, but when you look at the list of topics like that, which do you think worries you the most, and which do you think should be at the top of the agenda of policymakers for 2015?
Well, firstly, I think it's a very good thing that the World Economic Forum goes through this annual exercise. Most people engaged in public policy around the world do not have time to think. Therefore, a disciplined exercise to look beyond the radar and to look beyond the horizon is very important. So contributions like this, I think, are useful as a foundation point for the global discourse because there is inadequate planning nationally, globally, on the challenges that we face. In terms of the vast spectrum of challenges that we face in the decade ahead, and the World Economic Forum has produced 10 of them. I take a very simple premise, is that politics matters, and it can either be an enormous problem solver or a massive problem producer, and that is either politics nationally or internationally. So I, when I look at the unfolding challenges of the year ahead, look first and foremost at what are the extraordinary new phenomenon in geopolitics, which we now face. Of course, politics and geopolitics, if it goes wrong, can undermine everything else. And parallel to that, if I was identifying a second one, it's handmade in this exercise, is the rise of nationalism. So let me speak just for a little bit about those two thoughts. And I'm sure colleagues here will have different perspectives given their different professional prisms. On geopolitics, if you stand back and look at what has unfolded in the last year or so, we are looking at such a radically new geopolitical landscape compared with anything we thought was possible even 5 years ago, even really 3 years ago. I think we'd reached a conclusion that in our hearts and in our minds that the days of aggressive geopolitics lay with a previous century and not with the 21st century. Yet now what we have is massive challenges across the world, and we know the principal zones of engagement. We see the huge geopolitical challenges across the Middle East, across a number of states, and the potential fragmentation of states within this wider region. Secondly, we see the enormous new geostrategic tensions arising between Russia on the one hand and the European Union, the United States, and other countries on the other, on the question intrinsically of the Ukraine, but more broadly as well. And here we are, 25 years after the Berlin Wall came down, and we are looking at Mikhail Gorbachev warning us yesterday, literally, of the return of a second Cold War. And then thirdly, just lurking beneath the horizon in the hemisphere that I come from, which is Asia and the Pacific, in our hemisphere, we have a collection of 21st century globalizing economies sitting on the top of a bunch of 19th century geopolitical and nationalist realities where territorial tensions remain as acute as we've ever seen them. And so when you put those three things together, we are faced with a radical new geopolitical landscape. And let me just elucidate a little further on the question of Asia and the Pacific, because often it's not as acutely visible either in this part of the world or more broadly in Europe or in the Americas. When we see the rise of China, something I've been engaged in for 30, 35 years as a politician, a diplomat, a businessman, this is a earth-moving event. It's changing the tectonic plates in the sense that depending on how it's counted, if you accept the calculations on purchasing parity pricing or you accept market exchange rates calculations of gross domestic product, somewhere within the next decade, possibly this year, possibly a decade's time, China will be the largest economy in the world. And therefore, when we think of what that will mean in terms for the first time in a couple of hundred years, for a non-Western, non-democratic, non-English-speaking state to be the largest economy in the world, frankly, everything that people have assumed as being the normal state of international relations is going to have a whole new set of dynamics within it. That's at a global level. Then you go to the sub-regional components in terms of the unresolved territorial disputes, the Korean Peninsula, the disputes between China and Japan, disputes, obviously, which continue in relation to Taiwan, the South China Sea, which brings together six or seven different states, the unresolved nature of the Indian-Chinese border, the unresolved state of India-Pakistan. And in that region alone, you have something like six of the world's nuclear weapon states as well. And Asia, for the first time in the last year, having become the largest consumer, becoming a larger consumer of defense products than Europe in aggregate. And so this is the new emerging reality. And therefore, the level of statesmanship that's going to be required in managing these sort of drivers of change is more acute now than in any period that we have faced since the formal end of the last Cold War. And a final footnote on nationalism. And this goes to those who will speak on the question of where goes the global economy and the globalization project as well. Because political nationalism is not just something which exists in a person's head, it actually is driven by forces, either deep, unrequited anxieties about other states, or deep, unrequited anxieties about my own lot within my own state. And so, therefore, what we see, for example, with the emergence of the far-right parties in Europe, but also developments not dissimilar in many other parts of the world, is a deep questioning of which Piketty is simply one articulation of the politics of inequality and the reality of inequality, but frankly, the reality of the absence of opportunity. Put all those things together, as I said at the outset, there's always a danger we talk about politics and international politics too much, but it is the mechanism and the means by which we set international structures, international frameworks for dealing with the raft of other challenges, be they environmental, social, or economic. So my overall point is, these geopolitical challenges, nationalist and international, geostrategic and geopolitical and partly geoeconomic, are going to require the most careful handling so that they don't bring down the whole house of cards by accident.
On the point of nationalism, of course, we have noticed that in the European elections very clearly, but it's always a question of whether what we are seeing in those nationalist movements, is it a societal backlash against to the economic realities? And as I had mentioned, Ms. Mohammed, in my introduction, we always knew that income inequality is brewing somewhere underneath, but this year, it was the year where it came out to the public debate, and it's not anymore an elitist conversation. It became part of widespread debate because also the figures are scary. So why has it suddenly become part of the top agenda for 2015?
Thank you, Nadine, and congratulations on the to the Forum on the Outlook report for this year. Incredible. I think we're talking about shaping a new agenda, for one. So there is a conversation out there about how do we move from an agenda that reduced poverty to one that eradicates it. And then as we go along in that conversation, reviewing what we've done over the last decade or so, it becomes very clear that it's not just about eradicating poverty, that the inequalities issue is very big on the agenda. If anything, it's probably the greatest threat that we have to the next agenda that we put together. So I think there are many factors, and I see them in the trends. Leadership is one. But from a practitioner's point of view, I would say that not having the right policies that really address the way in which we inform the plans that we have to invest in these agendas is probably one of the biggest causes for these rising inequalities, that we see economies growing, and they're growing without people or consideration for the environment. And both of those are big factors for the tensions that we see today in many of our societies. I think we do need to take a look at those, the way in which we craft policies. Public policy itself in many countries, the institutional capacity to address the multidimensional aspects of it that all are around public policy is not there. And I think that we have a number of tools that are missing, the whole data issue of where you begin to even address policy and know which groups are you talking about. For us today, we clearly see that the policy choices that we have don't focus on the broad range of challenges that we have. So when we're talking about gender, age, discrimination, the rights agenda as we have it, this is all missing from what we're doing. And I think that that's really where we need to come back to that drawing board and say, you know, this is what we need to do to inform plans, and then perhaps we target better. Clearly, the redistribution of wealth is a big part of this, and how we do that at all levels. Inequality is rising not just within countries, but across countries as well, and it's global. It's a global issue that we all have to deal with. It isn't a cookie cutter for this, but it is very important that we do less also about targeting symptoms and really begin to do a lot more about the root causes of exclusion in what we're doing.
Yeah. I'd like to bring in Dr. Pozen to this discussion because As Ms. Mohammed said, inequality is everywhere. However, probably the reasons are different from place to place, especially the difference between the Western world and emerging economies. Doctor, do you think that in the United States, there was also the Occupy movement lately, which is also anti-globalization and capitalism. Do you think that it has become part of the debate, the issue of inequality, versus the calling for globalization and capitalism? Do you think that it's taking its necessary place in the public debate between policymakers?
I think it's very important that the outlook on the global agenda that the forum put together has identified not just inequality as one of the top issues, but the other economic issue is so-called jobless growth. And these two go together. I mean, I completely agree with Minister Rudd that in the background, you know, geopolitics triumphs overall, but as he said, it's a question of anxiety. And I think this has been part of the problem with the inequality debate. As the Assistant Secretary General said, we need to unpack inequality and be very clear about what we mean. So we toss around income inequality, wealth inequality. Let me try to put to you what I think are the key developments. The first is actually the good news that on a human scale, fewer people are in absolute poverty in the world today than at any time in human history. This is not just China, this is Eastern Europe, this is India, this is, we hope, starting now in sub-Saharan Africa. And we have to recognize that this was absolutely impossible to disentangle from globalization. We moved 1 billion people out of actual poverty because of globalization. And it's very hard to argue on human terms that anything is as important as that. However, that doesn't satisfy the local anxieties, the nationalisms, the issues within countries. And that's the second point we have to look at. That we talk in this sort of abstract way, and even Piketty and others who are ostensibly coming at a very radical point of view talk in this abstract way, but to pick up on a term the Assistant Secretary General used, exclusion is actually a huge part of this. This is about specified minorities. We know about the people in France and the banlieue. This is about specified minorities in various parts of the world. This is about women. This is not really about some disembodied thing that inequality is just sort of this generic trend. It really is about specific groups. The third point that I would talk about is taking that as sort of one of the more negative aspects. That, as Larry Summers says in his essay in the Outlook book, which is well worth reading, obviously, about jobless growth, this is about lack of education and, more importantly, lack of demand for low-skilled young men in rich countries. And it's not, and you have a mirror image in this region, which we saw play out politically in the events of the last few years, where there's insufficient demand for high-skilled young men in this region. But in the end, what we're talking about are fundamental shifts of technology and society that mean this precisely the type of people who are most likely to be violent or prone to nationalism or prone to unrest are the people who are being most displaced. And this is a key part of the political economy we have to address. From a more purely economic point of view, however, the news isn't as bad as you might think. Not only do we have this progress in human terms across the world, but we also have the fact that we know we can do something about income inequality. If you look at Europe for all its failures, and their failures are myriad right now, the fact remains that these outbursts of right-wing politics, these outbursts of intolerance, have actually been relatively contained, despite enormous unemployment comparable to the 1930s. And why is this? This is in large part because there is a well-functioning welfare state in Europe. The actual post-tax income inequality is much lower. And this is, of course, where the U.S. is so perverse. The U.S. has extraordinary income inequality, not so much because it is that different an economy than everybody else's, it's because it does not support any redistribution or any sizable redistribution. And you can say, well, that's a political acceptance. The part that you can't easily agree to anymore is the idea that, oh, this leads to much better performance by the U.S. There's some sort of Dickens trade-off, that if you look more like 1870, you outgrow everybody else. The U.S. is outgrowing people, but not by a huge amount. And so it's not like they're doing well by sacrificing inequality. One final point. I think it is very important as we look around the world that we pick up on one of the few, on two few constructive things that the, perhaps not the people of Davos, but the leaders of the G20 have done. We've seen two things advanced on the international economic agenda that should help. First is the push and the change in language that came out of the fall IMF World Bank meetings, a push towards infrastructure, a push towards public investment. That is a global push. That is something that is needed. There is a lot of discussion, a lot of groups within this conference that are working on aspects of that, public-private partnerships. Gordon Brown's leading a group. You know, there's a lot going on. But I think that that is one of the places where we can all agree there's huge benefits to be had. It would employ these men. It would provide better benefits and productivity going forward. It would help with the short-term growth problem. We really have to act on that. And the final piece is to think about some of the global tax issues. The OECD has shown some real leadership on this. There's new initiatives about avoiding, trying to limit tax avoidance, both corporate and personal. Again, this is not to say that everybody has to be taxed at French rates. That's not going to work. But it is to say that, well, it's not. There is a danger to everyone when there are small, let us call them offshore places, that provide distortions and escapes from legitimate taxation. And these are two areas where I think the international economic community can move forward.
I think you touched on two points that I will be going back to Ms. Mohammed with, which is the issue of education and the issue of taxation, on whether these can be viable solutions for the widening gap between rich and poor. But I'd like to actually draw on the point of inclusiveness that you mentioned, Doctor, to talk about the region, the Middle East. Dr. Dashti, we have seen, we have all witnessed what has happened in the Arab world. And initially, the spark was because of non-inclusive growth. Do you agree? Or because there is a certain link that the lack of jobs, especially youth unemployment, which featured high on the outlook for Middle Eastern policymakers' agenda, that this triggered the societal backlash and the political events, but then there are also the other theories. So I would like to hear your thoughts on that.
No question, Nadim, that the issue of inclusiveness, that the citizens of the region have seen that they're not beneficiary of this growth. And you see it in Egypt, you see it in Tunisia, the countries were growing at 8%, 9%, but the people and the masses, they're not reaping these benefits. So it was only targeted to a certain group, let alone the expectation of the future. People didn't see that they have, their future is bleak. The opportunities, countries are not creating opportunities for a better quality of life and standard of living. And people are dispersed to the extent that they're impatient. There's no more patience to give governments time to do any reforms. And this is what we see in countries, the uprising that happened in Tunisia, other countries in Egypt, Libya, and other places of it. Unfortunately, we're seeing chaos that came, and managing the expectations of the people who revolted is a very big challenge now with the governments who are handling, now they're coming into power. And here we come. We are in a time where there's so many complex issues and challenges that confront our region. And we never decided to take them serious and take serious reforms, thinking that we have ample of time. And time is on our side. Unfortunately, it's not. We have our population, we have a young population. In this region, GCC, we're talking about almost 65% is under the age of 29. So you have this youth bulge, have a lot of energy, but they have a lot of expectation for a better standard of living. And if you're not, and you're educating them, at the same time, you're not reaping the benefit of the education. So we're seeing a negative return on investment on education, unfortunately, in this region. But at the same time, this is energy. There is talent, energy, and it's not been utilized. So where do you think this young kid will go when this energy is not utilized in productive activities? And you're not creating opportunities for them.
But Dr. Dashti, we keep on talking about education, that you have an educated population, yet there are no jobs, so there seems to be a missing link there.
Yes. So the mismatch is very important. Now we're talking about, we moved into quantity, investment, just get people to be educated. We ended up becoming a credential societies vis-a-vis a knowledge societies. People just want to get a college degree. The content in the college degree is irrelevant to us. So you're getting societies that are credential societies. We just want to have a college degree. But real life, you need to have content, knowledge, so that you can produce, you can be a person demanded for their services, productive. Now it's an issue that the region will have to, again, invest in training and vocational training and on-job training so that it becomes this pool of adults are recruitable so that the private sector can recruit them. Because now we're also coming back into the private sector and you have to play a role. And you're getting the chicken and egg. I don't have a good qualified people. And then you tell the private sector, you need to invest in them, into it. And now we're having another rise. Not only the masses and the citizens are frustrated from the regimes, but now also they're frustrated from the private sector itself. Because they're seeing now that the transformation of the wealth is going from the state, for any reforms going on, and economic reforms, is going to go from the state to a group of people called the private sector and a certain families. And they're not going to see the benefits of it. So you're going to see also a big backlash from the citizens if you're on the private sector and energizing the private sector. Unless we're going to have a very concerted policies that takes into account that we're going to energize the private sector, making sure and ensuring that the masses are beneficiary of this growth.
But private sector, by definition, looks for profitability, for the bottom line. Dr. Pausen, he's giving me a sign, you have a very quick intervention, because I'd like to hear Mr. Majid Jafar's view on this.
At this point, and what you said, Nadine, about the missing link, that you're not getting the right demand, even for the educated. The greatest shortfall, the way this region stands out in the world, is its lack of globalization. Its lack of integration with the world economy, its lack of investment from abroad. And my colleague at Pearson Institute, Marcus Noland, has done a bunch of studies on this. And we find that those economies in the region that are more integrated with the rest of the world are the ones who do manage to generate the jobs. So it's another piece of this globalization process that the private sectors in this region, except for obviously the energy sector, tend to be very inward-looking and not open, and that's part of the problem.
But I can disagree a little bit in this. What safeguards some countries in this region is their limited globalization when the financial crisis occurred in the world. Also, it saves the countries
you,
also.
You can be globalized like China was without being exposed to international credits. And since most of the economies in this region are net savers, that's okay.
Let's hear Mr. Jafar's view on this, especially the debate about the jobs, the youth unemployment in the Middle East, although now it's much worse than it was before the political events happening in the region.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, it's been listed as persistent youth unemployment, but actually it is not only the highest region worldwide with youth unemployment now getting close to 30%, and I think that's actually understated, but it's the fastest rising. But I think in terms of the role of the private sector, just looking at all the priorities that came out, the 10 key issues in the report, all of them are universal. I mean, all of them apply to every part of the world. Of course, they apply differently, but they are universal challenges. And I think all of them require a multi-stakeholder approach. There isn't a single one that can be handled by just governments or just the private sector or just, you know, academia or international international organizations. They all require a multi-stakeholder approach. Now, turning to the Middle East and the issue of youth unemployment, unlike some other regions such as Southern Europe, where it has emerged post the financial crisis, it's been a chronic problem that we've been talking about for decades and warning about in this region. But overlaid, we've had the political upheavals and the global financial and economic crisis, and now open conflict. I mean, there are some wars going on, of course, in our region. So it's gone from that chronic problem now to an acute crisis. And there's a sense of urgency that unfortunately isn't being reflected. Because, and the media and so on.
Because people prioritize, when you have a war ongoing, the priority becomes that instead of the underlying
problem. That, and it's actually hard to show on Al Arabi or any TV station, youth unemployment. I mean,
I think we have the biggest space for business news among all the channels in the region.
No, absolutely, so. But I mean, how do you present those millions of people sitting at home who can't find opportunity. It's a challenge. And the causes in our region are not unique. They're the same as everywhere. It's insufficient growth, the education skills mismatch to what the market requires, which is what we heard about, and rigid labor markets in many of these countries. But there a lot of focus then ends up on, you know, entrepreneurship and reforms. But actually, we went from growth that was not inclusive to now no growth at all in
exactly.
many countries in the region.
So
actually, we without the engine of growth, we can't. We'll worry about the distribution if we can actually achieve some growth. Many large economies in the region now are either flat or shrinking as a result of all this turmoil. I do want to echo the point on infrastructure and the infrastructure gap. It's very clearly defined in our region. The World Bank estimates between $75 and $100 billion of infrastructure investment requirements annually. There's very little spent. Most government spending in the region is on recurrent expenditure of subsidies and government sector salaries.
And you're talking about resource-based economies with a lot of resources and oil wells.
I mean, the gaps are across the region, not just in the resource economies. In fact, more in perhaps economies that aren't as well endowed. But if we look at the region overall, you're absolutely right. There are trillions of dollars in state coffers. There's also trillions of dollars in the private sector. But the right mechanisms need to be put in place to unleash that within the region on productive investment that's going to create sustainable job creation for the next generation. Otherwise, we'll keep chasing our tail. We'll never achieve the political stability unless we start tackling some of these economic priorities now.
Before taking your comments, Mr. Rudd, I'd like to point out that later on I will be taking questions from the audience. I'd like you to interact with our panelists, so please start preparing your questions so that we can give you the chance to address them to the speakers a little bit later. Your comment, Mr. Rudd.
Well, I think the conversation is a very rich one because we are dealing with the totality of the global challenge. Before I spoke about geopolitical challenges and national political challenges, they are real and they're foundational if something radical goes wrong. And there's a few things out there which should cause us some real concern. Then at the second level, we've had this discussion, and I certainly thank Adam Posen for his contribution about the state of global growth and the global economy, because its ricochet effect around the global system is profound as well. But the summary point is this: our existing global system, our existing global order, is in a state of increasing crisis in terms of its ability to cope with all of the above. That is what we require a focused discussion and conclusion on, not just in the WEF, but in the international community.
Is it lack of leadership?
Now,
who's
not
leading the world, basically?
It's not a time to bash the Yanks or to bash anyone in particular. Let's all just reflect on ourselves for a moment, wherever we've come from. And just get to some basic realities here. Take, for example, the core question of global growth. If you look at the institutional mechanism for managing global growth at present, what is it? We have the Bretton Woods architecture, which remains, and you have a G20 overlay, and of course you have national institutional arrangements. Well, the truth is, if we are looking at the current state of global growth, whether it is sustainable or not, and inclusive or not, we have an extraordinary global economic growth deficit. Now, why is that the case? And what can be done about it? If you look at the G20, 5 years ago, it identified the need for a new global growth agenda. And it basically challenged the international community to respond in terms of what could drive growth in the future. Item number one: at last bring about a global trade outcome on Doha. 5 years later, no global outcome on Doha.
The opposite, there's protectionism increasing.
Well, it's out there, but what I'm saying is that if you're looking to add a new increment to growth, and depending on which calculations you believe, you're looking at in the direction of almost a percentage point of global growth over time, which can be produced by a genuine global trade liberalization outcome. political will doesn't exist for that. The WTO hasn't got there, the G20 hasn't got there, other institutions, including the various bilateral and plurilateral arrangements, haven't got there as well. Result? It's not a growth driver. Number two, infrastructure. The only encouraging sign I see on the infrastructure front, apart from the fact that we're all still debating it, is this, that when you look at the availability of global public capital to deal with the infrastructure deficit in the world, in Asia alone, the calculation, I think, I'm looking for my Chinese colleagues and Japanese colleagues, it's a couple of trillion, as recently calculated. The availability of global public capital through the Asian Development Bank, even if you add the Chinese proposal for an Asian infrastructure bank, is way south of that, even if you roll in the World Bank. So here is the key challenge for the global system. How do we actually use global public capital to make it possible for the vast quantums of global private capital, either in sovereign wealth funds or in major private investment institutions, to be unleashed in the direction of the global growth agenda? And I think a whole creative re-examination of how you leverage infrastructure developments across the world, cocktailing financial products, using global public capital to reduce the risk profile either of the project or in the country concerned, to make it possible for the tens, hundreds of billions and trillions of dollars necessary to unleash this new growth drive. Public capital won't get there. ODA won't get there. But together you can cocktail this in a remarkably positive and constructive way. And what's the third one? If we're serious about climate change, and for God's sake at this time in the 21st century, I'd hope we were, and if we're serious about it and bring about an outcome in Paris, then let's hope we can. The transformational opportunities for the global economy through the renewable energy sector are massive also in terms of its capacity to generate new growth. Now, there are the pathways forward. Trade liberalisation, massive infrastructure revolution, new sources of finance, and rather than being permanently frightened by the adjustment challenges of climate change, turn it into a massive economic opportunity. Our systems at present globally aren't grasping that effectively. And so the challenge for us as an international community, without pointing the finger at Beijing or Washington or anybody, is to use our collective voice through the institutions of the international community, the crux of which is the United Nations system, to make it work, in which we all have a voice.
I'd like to hear your comment, Mr. Mohammed. Do you think that this is where it starts to find the needed jobs? Mr. Larry Summers, as Dr. Posen has mentioned in the Outlook, argues that actually we should make use of low borrowing costs, of underutilized labor forces to spend on infrastructure, and this could be the trigger for creating the jobs that are needed. So where are you from that argument?
We're saying the same thing that Kevin is saying in the discussions that we're having on financing and resourcing the sustainable development agenda right now. I think what we do need is that leadership all the way through to bring that collective voice with commitments. We've talked about it. We've realized that this is what we need to do. But to do it really needs that collective voice. Where is that collective voice going to come from? Well, we hope that in the next 6 to 8 months we can bring that with business, with the multilateral system and member states to the fore and really make that happen. I think if it doesn't, then the implications will be a continued discussion on the rising inequalities that we can see what that does. But I want to go back to the education question, because I think that that's something that we've underestimated. We've all spoken about education as a building block, the cornerstone. Everybody buys into that's what you need for sustainable development. But we've not done it in a way that we need to really underpin everything that we're speaking about. It's been discussed in silos. We've talked about goals that have really addressed access. And even in terms of access, we looked at some of the gaps that we had that we didn't know very well, but we just knew girls were not getting educated, so let's put a focus on girls. And I think in the last 10 years, we've put a real focus on it. We have shifted the needle. But in doing that, we left the boys behind. And even those that got through the education system have passed through education, but education hasn't quite passed through them. And so what we've ended up with is a lot of young people without the skill sets, very basic skill sets. If you look at the statistics in Africa, in fact, not just in Africa, across the globe, reading and writing and math, all deficits. And this is basic skills. And without that foundation, even though you talk about the certificates, I'm afraid those certificates ought to be questioned. So there's a whole retooling that has to be done for a generation of children that haven't had the education that they need. The quality is totally missing out of that. And in many cases, they haven't completed education. The right set of skills that we talk about to meet the marketplace, there's also a disconnect there. When we sit at the table planning the investments that we make in education, we do them outside of what the economy wants to achieve. There's no connect there with it at all.
It's not addressing the needs of the economy, of the job market.
Doesn't address it. You ask a child what they want to be, the last thing in the room is nobody wants to be a teacher. You need teachers. Nobody wants to be a carpenter. Everybody wants to be a banker, a doctor. I mean, it's a discussion that you don't help inform even at the level of making those choices about what we need that will be beneficial to empowering children as they leave school. That's at the basic level. So I think we need to big focus on what teachers are doing. Knowledge and learning. Curriculums that are fit for countries at the level they are, and not that we cut and paste them because we think this is the best for around the world so that you've got skills that you can exchange across globally. I mean, you have to think about the national level. Most national curriculums are not functional. We're missing citizen education. Many of our countries that have fragile states and coming out of conflict don't educate that population that have been through a different environment that need different skills. There's a mismatch of technology. There's so much of it available, but how you use it, you miss the teacher and give it to the child. Technology is not going to teach the child. You need to see it as a tool. There are many levels of this at the very basic level that we're missing. Science is not there. We're talking about transforming economies, technology, science. But at the very basic level, we are not investing in that. So I think that we do have to find the KPI for the Minister of Finance has to be what impact they get in terms of educational outcomes, but how that's linked to empowerment and job. And then, you know, just making sure that you aren't leaving anyone behind. It's too difficult to reach everyone. No, you have to reach everyone, and it is possible.
Dr. Dashti, I would like to move on from the economics to the political angle of what is happening in the region. But I would like a comment first on what Ms. Mohammed mentioned, that we do have the education, but for example, we are lacking the vocational training. Where is the vocational training in the Arab world? Everybody wants to be a government employee because that's the easy way out. And even though you mentioned the problem that the private sector is also to blame partly, but how do we start solving this issue? Before I move on to the political angle of what is happening in the region, and whether you said also in your contribution that you think that these economic problems and the lack of jobs is creating the sectarian tension that we are seeing in the Arab world.
There's no question, Nadim. We need to energize the economy. We need to have a growth. But at the same time, at least I'll say the specificity of the GCC region. Capital expenditure, infrastructure investments will not create the jobs, the required jobs for the nationals. And this is where we come to say we need now to revisit, we need to have a responsible private sector, we need to have a responsible citizens now to look forward to the issue. Because now when you get all these big mega projects require labor, what type of labor? We're gonna be importing labor. So it's all non-nationals. And the jobs we are looking for, the creation of the jobs, is we're talking about there's nationals, they're demanding jobs. Now, looking at the nationals also, there's the issue of the value of work, work ethics. Now, they have to become responsible. So it's not only the issue of job creation is not only hindered on government itself, but at the same time, we need to have responsible private sector that also take the initiative and spend some money to invest in hiring nationals to play its role, its required role as a private sector. At the same time, nationals also needs to invest so that to get out of is happening. Because now we will see in the GCC region at least, we have voluntarily unemployment. People will be willing to not work and be unemployed until they find the right job in the government space or a right job in a certain private sector and will not be willing to take other jobs because of the culture of value of work. And now we're saying this compounds the problem. And it compounds the problem not from economic loss of energy and the resources itself, but it compounds on the social and the political, which will come back back to it. So we do have to start managing the issue of unemployment. It's not only education. Vocational training is unfortunate. We have lost it. We have lost the investment in the vocational through vocational training. Now you're ending up, have to do it now on the training and retraining of the graduates itself. You invest in them and on the job training, where the private sector have to start investing on the job training to start picking up the required talents into the labor force.
Mr. Jafar, there is today a new input, let's say, it's the what's happening in the oil markets. There is a new element to take into consideration. We are talking about the problems in the GCC at a time when oil prices were at $115 per barrel and the governments have a lot of savings. But now we are entering a new stage in the world where the United States is producing more than 8.5 million barrels a day. Today we are seeing every day in the news the announcements of how the GCC producers are shifting to sell their oil in Asia because of what is happening in the United States. So, and we saw this drive for nationalizing jobs in the GCC. Did it pay off? What kind of challenges are we looking at now with the new norm of oil prices between $70 and $80 probably?
So, despite the fact that oil prices had been stable at $110 or so for the last few years, the talk of a collapse, I think, is a bit premature. I mean, it wasn't that long ago oil prices were $12 and $15 and even as low as $9. I think most of the, well, many of the governments in the region budgeted lower than where the oil price was and closer to where it is now, and as you mentioned, have significant savings. There are some countries in the region that don't have that luxury and or are getting through turmoil, such as Iraq, and budgeting at higher oil price. And there's been a lot of focus on, you know, the geopolitical considerations and the supply, and is it within OPEC, is it about U.S. shale? Actually, not enough attention has been given to the demand side. And that's actually the most important driver. In particular, China and the Chinese economic outlook is probably the number one factor that's going to impact oil prices. Now, in terms of the role of the private sector and hiring, absolutely. I mean, governments across the region, whether in the GCC or in the wider Middle East, North Africa region, are at capacity in terms of state-provided jobs. And the new ones that are being provided the state by the state are less productive as a result. But there is this expectation, and it is an issue around the world when we talk about you know, rising incomes also lead to higher expectations. And so the type of jobs that people would accept changes, it's not just in this region. We've seen countries like Brazil and Turkey with very good economic results and then suddenly unrest in the streets because people's expectations are higher now. In this region, we do have this challenge that on the one hand, governments asking the private sector to hire more people, but the private sector operates in a market. And you know, you can't artificially somehow expect that they're going to share in the burden if the government is doing distortive things, such as just raising salaries or hiring more. The two are somehow at odds. We actually analyzed that, the Regional Business Council of the Middle East North Africa in the World Economic Forum that I had the honor to chair over the last year. We focused exactly on this issue, these different dynamics, how on the one hand the new jobs are going to come in the private sector. On the other hand, there are things government is doing in the short term today that's going to make that more challenging over the long term. So it does need to be, once again, a collective action.
I want to open the... please go ahead, Dr.
For the issue of the oil prices, And I think this is the big challenge now on fiscal budgets for the governments of this region, at least the GCC regions, all exporters. And I think the problem rests on regimes in our region. If they think they can still maintain the middle income class that they created, which is fake to me, okay, is the question now. Because there will be a lot of pressure on the fiscal budgets, and maintaining this middle income class could not be sustainable with the current policies we have, and if not, we're going to reform it. We do have a middle income class which is creating the social stability in the GCC countries because the governments have created them. And these middle income class are consuming of the oil wealth, oil and gas wealth, but they're not generator of wealth for the state. At the end of the day, if the oil wealth is shrinking and the income coming generated from them, this growing middle income class, because we have huge population growth rates, almost 2.7% in this region, okay, how do you sustain it? So you're going to end up, if you're not gonna transfer your middle income class from a consuming middle income class to wealth generating middle income class, you're gonna end up seeing a shrinking middle income class, and you're gonna end up seeing starting a social instability, social unrest in the GCC region as we go along. That's why we say there is an urgency of reform. Time is against us if we want to sustain the stability of the countries.
Already we started hearing of many governments in the GCC saying, preparing the people about cut in subsidies and such measures. I want to move on to the issue of oil. There are so many ideas out there that it might be the oil producers in the Gulf are happy with lower prices because it helps with the sanctions on Iran. Some think that it's better because of the sanctions on Russia right now, that it's a good tool. And we're starting to hear for the first time the use of oil as a tool for the political agendas. And some say it's good for the United States because it will stop the investment in shale, so the Gulf producers are happy with that. I will get your point of view on these issues, but first let me take some questions from the audience. I would like to welcome, we have with us 8 young people from Dubai who are part of the World Economic Forum Global Shapers. They are sitting with us here today, so thank you for being with us. Please raise your hand if you have any question for our panelists, and can we pass on the microphone, and kindly introduce yourself first and what you do before you addressing your question.
Thank you very much. My name is Hisham Yusuf, and I'm from the Organization of Islamic Cooperation. Just a very, very brief remark regarding the trends. I think there are two very important trends that I was hoping to see in this report that I did not see in the list of 10 priorities. The first one is in relation to our failure in early warning or translating early warning into early action. And as a result, we have a situation whereby ISIS or Daesh is controlling large parts of both Iraq and Syria, and with very little to show in relation to being able to predict that or being able to act on it in an effective way. The second point is in relation to humanitarian crises. We are having now a huge gap in financing humanitarian crises in Syria, Iraq, Yemen, Sudan, Somalia, Central African Republic, and now Ebola. And I think this will result in a huge problem affecting even peace and security. And Lebanon and its fragility is one example of how things can deteriorate in this regard. Thank you.
Ms. Mohammed, would you like to comment on the humanitarian financing?
It's become a big discussion for us on whether how far you include that that part of the investment on the development agenda. Clearly, it has been with us and it has been with ODA, but you know the background to which we are dealing with the humanitarian crisis now is not only expanding, but it has come into the development arena where we've got years of trying to contain that environment. And many of the countries coming out of conflict also pose the same challenge. I think it's clear that we are looking for innovative ways of bringing in the private sector to deal with the humanitarian funding crisis and how we do that, because the public funds are certainly not enough. We're not going to, even the ODA that we talk about now does not meet the commitments, and so therefore The argument that we continue to invest in what would be perceived as a symptom and rather than get to the cause and put more into LDCs and in investing in development becomes that tension. I think one of the things that we've been able to see as an argument for better investments, more targeted, deeper than we've had before in health systems and education, is clearly the Ebola crisis. That's just a reflection of states that don't have the capacities or systems to respond, budgets and the personnel that are needed for it. And so one should see that better reflected in the next agenda.
Just on the early warning system, if I could add to what Amina has just said, and she's absolutely right about the crisis we face with the available supply of global capital to deal with the multiplicity of challenges. And by the way, to acknowledge the excellent work which the OIC does in the field, which I've seen in many parts of the world. I think the UN is now doing a lessons learned in terms of the failure of EWS, early warning systems on Ebola, but it is broader than that. We can also point to areas where the UN has succeeded with EWS. Think of the emerging drought in Somalia some years ago, where the WFP succeeded in actually forward positioning large food supplies in critical areas because the meteorologists indicated we're about to have a big drought in East Africa, or certainly in the Horn of Africa. So there are positives and negatives. We've seen a very big negative most recently, but here's the core challenge. And it goes back to a system problem. It goes back to an order problem, a global order problem. Humanitarian crises of one form or another are not getting less, they're getting more, and they're becoming more complex. And it's partly a product of the globalizing world in which we are in, and partly because of the impact of climate change, and partly for a whole bunch of other reasons as well to do with fragile states and geopolitics. And so when you look at 140 billion, or a bit less now, I think, Amina, in terms of global ODA, the call on the ODA budget globally just to deal with humanitarian crises is consuming this hugely. Valerie Amos is with us at this conference. She does a terrific job in trying to, with UN OCHA, in trying to pull together the call for funds each time we have a new crisis. And she will constantly tell you how thin the biscuit barrel is on each one of these things. Now, my point in system terms is these humanitarian crises can't be waved away. They are simply there and becoming larger in number and more complex. Therefore, we have to have the funding flexibility to deal with them. If we don't have the institutional capability of dealing with causalities in terms of fragile states. So then what about education? Where's the money lie then for what should be, you know, the Global Education Organization, the GEO, there's a new term
it
for
it. It goes back to prioritizing.
Well, that's not a prioritizing thing. We've got to actually be creative about how we deploy new lines of capital. For example, in the necessary education revolution, which must occur worldwide, for basic educational opportunity, it can't all come from ODA. Obviously, national budgets are critical. Well, how do we leverage new private sources of capital for this as well? How do we leverage the new technologies we see evidence of with digital utilization in parts of Africa? But what I'm saying is the traditional view that a bucket of ODA each year will basically be that which exists in finite form to solve the extraordinary challenges which the UN system now faces is wrong. The system actually has to embrace a systemic change in order to open up new lines of capital to deal with it.
Before taking another question, Dr. Pozen, I'd like to go back to you with the question that I had raised earlier. There is a feeling in this part of the world that there is a US disengagement from the region. On one hand, we waited till September to hear that the Obama administration didn't have a clear strategy to deal with ISIS. All kinds of theories are out there. One of them is the pivot to Asia that we have heard from the Obama administration earlier. Another one is that this is the result of self-sufficiency in terms of energy needs for the United States. So what is your take on this discussion?
I mean, I should not wander too far into geopolitics because it's not my expertise. I will say the following. Every region, even the legendary Asia, feels like the U.S. has pivoted away.
Why is that?
And I think it's a combination of fatigue that, for all the goods and bads of direct U.S. military intervention in recent years, there is, as there's been repeatedly in U.S. history, a sense of fatigue and disappointment that we put out lives and treasure and we didn't get what we wanted. Now, that may have been completely unrealistic, but the fact remains among the people of the U.S., among the voters of the U.S., and among the political class of the U.S., there is a repeated cycle of that sort, and we're seeing it now. I think, secondly, the energy independence or sufficiency or that is a marginal effect. I think it's there, but I don't think that that should be exaggerated. I think the other thing besides the sort of geo-military fatigue is a sense of, frankly, economic uncertainty, that the U.S. has come out of the last few years looking like it's won a least ugly contest. You know, compared to a Japan, a France, a U.K., perhaps not in Australia, you know, the U.S. feels like, okay, we're still better off than a lot of these other rich countries that have really messed up, but it's hard to beat our breasts about our performance the way the U.S. probably exaggeratedly did in 2000-2002. So you put all that together, it's an internal lack of confidence, increase in sense of limitation on the U.S. It's less, I think, region specific, frankly, than this region perceives it.
Does anyone here think that it has to do also with this geopolitical competition that we are seeing in the world, this polarized world that we have between the Western powers on one side and now Russia on the other, let's say? How much are these things interlinked? I don't know who would like to answer that, Mr. Rudd.
To build on what has just been said by Dr. Posen, look, we, the rest of the world, have got a responsibility to step up to deal with our regional problems and challenges. I mean, it's not the universal responsibility of the United Nations, it's not the universal responsibility of the United States. Whether it's in Europe, whether it's in the Middle East, or whether it's in our part of the world as well. And this is not just national security challenges, it's economic and developmental and humanitarian crisis challenges as well. I think that's a really important point. On the challenge of geopolitics, I think this is an extraordinarily complex time we are now living through. I think when we look back in the history books, we're going to point to 2013, 2014 as big change years for the emerging structure of the global order. Kissinger didn't write a book entitled Global Order for nothing this year. Kissinger wrote it because he's worried about it. And if there's one bloke who knows a bit about the global order, whether you like him or loathe him, it's Henry. And he's saying that the global order and the international system which exists within it is under challenge, partly because of reasons of US national political fatigue, partly because the array of global problems is now of a density and complexity and frequency, which has frankly defied the system that we put together back at the San Francisco conference. So I think to go back to my continuing refrain, rather than one which says, well, what are the Americans going to do about that? Or what will the Chinese do about this to place the burden on my good friends from Beijing? It's what are we going to do about all this? And we actually have a system. You know, people mock the United Nations all the time. You know, I'd like to say to this audience, if not the United Nations, then what?
Then what? Exactly. The alternative is really bad. Let's hear from the voices from the region on that. Are you worried about changing in the map of the region as a result of all of this?
So looking at this region and indeed globally, I think what Mr. Rudd said is very true, and it's a very, very strange time because economically, it's more globalization, and companies are acting more globally, in particular in this region, I think in every region. And yet governments are, you know, so companies and the economy is sort of 21st century and going forward. Governments everywhere seem to be going back to 19th century fault lines, whether in Asia, whether in the Middle East, and even in Europe.
They're not equipped to deal with the new reality.
It's very difficult for whether a large multinational or a regional private sector player to be planning on investments when you know these things are occurring. I do think, and the outlook shows, that there is a crisis of confidence. There's a crisis of confidence in national governments. Only 55% didn't have confidence in the transparency and accountability of their national governments, and this is across worldwide. But then even worse, at the global governance level, whatever that concept means to people, there is a sort of sense that there should be, whether UN, other institutions, or the way that, that state players and other stakeholders engage at the global level, there should be a sense of global governance tackling some of these issues. 85% of those polled thought it was being very poorly translated in this outlook on all of the priority issues and others. So there is this crisis of confidence in leadership.
Dr. Dashti.
Nadeem, I'll just add to what what's been said about reshaping our region. I think with the rise of societal polarization, and if governments in this region doesn't stand up to tackle the challenges that are confronting us in a serious manner, we will be ending up redrawing and reshaping our. It's us, not from the outside. It's not someone else or some other institution or countries will redraw it for us. We will end up redrawing it with the societal polarization that we're seeing now and the challenges that is confronting us. And this is why we keep on saying there is an urgent need to look into the issues and to reform serious reforms and tackling them, not only on the economic front, but also on the political and social front. Every country in this region, in the Arab region, in the MENA region, has its specificity. But all of them, with no exception, are in urgent need for political, social, and economic reform if they would like to sustain and to continue the stability they would love to have and create the opportunities for its citizens.
Let's take a few questions from the audience before wrapping up. Can we pass on the microphones to the second row and then the third row? So we'll take them in order. Please don't forget to introduce yourself first.
Amr Khashoggi, the head group Saudi Arabia. The most important asset of a nation are the generation next. And yet we offer very poor salaries to our teachers who take care of our children. And at the same time, we don't communicate enough with the household, with the homes of these children. We entrust them to people who are poorly educated. So how do we work together in improving that with the aim of providing education for employment at the end of the day?
Thank you. Who would like to answer that question? Ms. Mohammed.
Yeah, okay. I mean, a lot of what we need for education is in a recurrent budget. It needs domestic resource mobilization to make that sustainable, to get the kind of investments we need in the teachers and the classroom in the type of quality education that we have. And so I think when we speak about the funding mix that you need to make that happen, we need to release some of those resources that public funds are used on in terms of infrastructure and other capital expenditures in this innovative financing that unlocks other resources to come in so that you can release more of the money to go for this kind of expenditures in health, in education. I think that's what we really do need to look at. If I look at the budget in our country, it's a huge amount that's needed to actually service in a federal system all the way through 169 million people. We don't have it, and in order to get it, we need investments in infrastructure so we can look at industrializing and creating the value chains that we need. And that needs resources, that needs foreign direct investment, that needs innovative financing. And I think once we start to get the whole picture together, not just speaking about education on its own because it's a social right, but that we see it as an integral part of success in a macroeconomic framework. That's one way to go down that line. But it's for education. We've asked a huge social media platform that the UN has that's asked the, you know, young people, what is it they want to see? It's education, it's health, and then there's an interchange between jobs and a responsive government. Again, that goes back to the governance issue.
I can add very quickly, Dr. Dashti.
Yes, very quickly, I can add one thing. Look how we look into the quality of teachers. The College of Education
still in the
recruits the lower tier of high school graduates. We're not looking at education as a professional degree like medicine.
Because the pay is not similar. It's a vicious circle. It's not an attractive proposition because the pay
I'll give an example. In Kuwait, we have increased the pay scale of the teachers. So tremendous. But it didn't mean that the quality of the teacher have improved. We need to think this is a profession to get it, to get the quality of the people who are coming to the education system, who are going to teach our kids. Let alone you have to reform the curriculum, let alone to have other things. But the quality of teacher need to be revisited. Mm-hmm. College of Education in our part of the world have to be revisited to become a professional degree, to recruit the right people to, so that they become the instructors of our kids.
Doctor, we will take three more questions. I hope we can have quick answers. You already have the microphone, so please go ahead.
Thank you very much. Paul Hodges from the United Kingdom. If I could return to the question of economic growth, and the issue to me, one of the key issues which we haven't yet touched on is demographics, where the Middle East and Africa are the exceptions of having very high fertility rates and very relatively very small older populations. If we look at the wealthy parts of the world, the States and Europe, if we look at Northeast Asia, we see that for 40 years we've had, in many parts of those areas, fertility rates of less than replacement level. So we inevitably have a very small generation by comparison in the wealth creation 25 to 54 age group. We also, for the very first time in history, have a group of people who are now alive and active up to 55, over 55, up to 70. Seems to me if we're going to regain growth, we've got to address these demographic realities.
Okay.
And I'd like to know what people think we could do, particularly this new old 55 generation who are being left into retirement at the moment.
Who would you like to answer your question? Quickly, Dr. Posen, and then Dr.
Just two quick points. One, you're absolutely right. Future growth drivers depend on dealing with a demography and all of its complexity. One part of it's a global challenge. Our Chinese friends are acutely conscious of this. Their own population will peak 2025, 2027, and therefore they face a massive set of challenges we're all familiar with, and them in particular. But in the countries that you've just referred to, where the innovation must occur is firstly in terms of public pension entitlements and how they are funded over time. We've sought to do this in Australia with some success. But the other is, frankly, opening up the labour market flexibility for older people to participate, frankly, as long as they want to, rather than what we've had so far. The second and related point about demography as a growth driver, frankly, goes back to the question of gender equality and access. If you look at the numbers that I've seen produced around the world about what happens to the global growth equation if we unleash women and girls and all their economic potential across the world, most of our problems that we've been talking about in this area, at least in the economic context, would disappear overnight. Well, not
Definitely.
Overnight. And this is directly related to education investment. It's also related to the question of the behavioural patterns of mothers and of women who are the best savers in the world, the best starters of micro-enterprises in the world, and yet the folks around the world who have the least opportunity. Unleash that with some infrastructure investment, unleash that
okay,
with some renewable energy and a free trade deal, problem solved.
Dr. Posen, quickly.
But this is assuming that there is opportunities To use the education.
Yeah, you have to change the mindset. Dr. Posen.
Let me just pick up on what Minister Rudd said in one way and then add one more thing. I think I spoke about it, everyone on this panel has spoken about it. It is the issue of utilizing female labor force in the right way. We have a very current example. There's a lot of bad things said about Japan, understandably. But the fact is, in the last year and a half, the Abe administration made a decision that the only way they were going to get out of their mess was better utilization of female labor force participation, and it's up 2.5% in 18 months. That's 500,000 women who are now being properly employed and utilized, even though they'd already been educated, but had been excluded in Japanese society, economic society. So it can be done, and it matters. The second point is just to pick up, I think the danger is to get too caught up in demographic determinism. I know that's not what the gentleman was saying, but we have to be careful about that because it becomes an excuse. Oh, the Europe can't cope with its welfare states, has to do this because there are too many old people. Oh, the Middle East cannot employ all too many young people. You can actually succeed in any demographic situation. You just have to think about it and pursue what you got. And to the degree the demographic situation is a problem, it's like the weather. You know, you have to live with it.
I want to apologize from all the people who wanted to ask questions, but unfortunately we're running over time and I know that you are going later on to another event, so I'm really sorry. Maybe you can talk directly to the panelists right after we finish. Thank you very much for being here with us, and thank you for the panelists for a lovely discussion.